Second, conflicts are coming down in Africa. Conflicts that we saw in the 80s and 90s, 70s, conflicts are coming down. Now, in most of the countries, you don't have those violent conflicts that we had. Nigeria, Boko Haram, Al-Shabaab in Eastern Africa, and Al-Qaeda of the Maghreb, you know, in Libya, Mali. These are Islamic fundamentalists. They are not like the ethnic conflict. Real ethnic conflicts are coming down considerably. What we have is, you see, what happens is, he's a Jew, he's an American, one of the best political scientists, and he has a book called, you can get part of it online, The Crash of Civilizations. Read that book. One of my best books. The Crash of Civilization. Civilization by Samuel Huffington. And in this book, he's saying that after the Cold War, you know the Cold War between Russia and NATO and Moscow. After the Cold War, the world changed from a bipolar world, bi means two, so you have the Soviet Union and America in a bipolar world. Bipolarity changed into a unipolar world. America became the only big power. Into a unipolar world. And the change from bipolarity to unipolarity meant that the Cold War has ended. And Huffington says that there are going to be new forms of conflict. The West is going to try to universalize. There's going to be a process of westernization through globalization of Western civilization. And this Western civilization, which is spreading, is going to be opposed by the Islamic civilization. And so the next conflict will be a clash of these two civilizations, Islam and Western culture. And 9/11, the World Trade Center, which was bombed, he predicted all in this group, that Islamic civilization and Western culture are going to violently crash. If we come to Africa, it's here. I mean, Al-Shabaab, Boko Haram, they have links with ISIS, the Islamic State. And the thing they're doing is to try to Islamize Africa, you know, to make Islam the dominant thing. And so it is not the same ethnic conflict we saw in the 70s and 80s. The nature of the conflict have changed. And Africa is relatively peaceful now than before. They are under attack because in Niger, Nigeria, and Cameroon, Nigeria cannot fight Boko Haram because they are corrupt. All the defense budget of Nigeria, maybe it's bigger than the budget of Kuwait, but the politicians take all the money. So the soldiers haven't got things to fight. So new conflicts, you know, but the traditional ethnic conflicts, the political instabilities, they are stopping. Nigeria, for the first time, has changed power through the ballot box. Ghana has done it 3 times. There was a president, he loses, then he hands over to the opposition. Peacefully, the opposition loses, hands over to the other one. Now the third one, he loses. We win the elections on Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, he calls the other man and says, good, you've won, take the power. So something is happening. Democracy is taking root. You know, some consolidation. Nigeria never did this. So it seems to me that investment, capital investment or infrastructural investment can begin to take place. Now, investors are beginning to come. Because people investing their monies don't want to invest money in a place where there's violence, where there's conflict. But when there's peace and stability, and there's the rule of law, they will come in. And Ghana has seen a lot. Our oil, there's not a Ghanaian company drawing the oil. They are from US and Canada. Big contracts. So something is happening. Conflicts are giving way. Democracy is taking root. Though it's painfully slow, very painfully slow, and yet it is happening. Anybody who comes to Ghana, who has been there before in the last 30 years and comes today, will see different things. Right from the airport, new building, things are changing. Things are changing. And more freedoms are being won. Human rights are being respected. There's tolerance. Christians and Muslims are living side by side. Even with Boko Haram, as I said, can Nigeria say that with all the money they have, they can't fight this group? But the Muslims of the north and some Muslims in national security are giving information to Boko Haram. So they compromise intelligence. Anytime they plan, they leak it. You know, people from northern Nigeria and so on. Ghana, Boko Haram cannot come. Just before Mahama left, two terrorists from the US, Obama said they wanted to bring them to Ghana. They're in Ghana now. Maybe you heard this. During the war against terror, they arrested them and took them to Cuba on the island, Guantanamo Bay. So America wants to let them go, but they don't know where. So every country except, do you have some here? In Ghana, in the media, and in public discourse, like, we don't want them. It is part of the reason why Mahama lost the elections. We don't want these people are terrorists. And now the new government says he's going to talk to America. They can stay in America. Not. You see, so as a matter of fact, the picture is changing. The picture is changing. The kinds of ethnic conflict we saw 15, 20, 10 years ago, it's not happening now. Are they happening? They recruit always from the poor sections of society. I mean, if I'm a millionaire, I won't go and be a suicide bomber. So the poor sections of society who are hopeless and who have no stake in society, that is the recruiting ground for terrorists. So one of the things is to fight poverty, you know, try to deal with poverty. And once you deal with poverty, it becomes very difficult because most of these young guys who are fighting and who are doing suicide bombing for Boko Haram and so on, they are young guys who are from poor backgrounds, who have no stake in the society, and so they can do these things. So there is a certain link between poverty and conflict, as we saw, or recruitment. One of the things we do is to try to put in place pro-poor agenda to help poor people, to go to school, to try to create jobs, to try to end social exclusion, you understand? Yeah. Once you try to end social exclusion, then you'll be moving. Why? Boko Haram is recruiting from northern Nigeria. That's where they are poor people. So infrastructure can be built, and it's being built. In some of the countries, they are building infrastructure. It may be slow, and sometimes the problem is not the conflict, the problem is of the financing, how you get the money to do it and all that. But clearly, it's one of the options. The second one, trade and investment, the promotion of trade and investment. Trade promotion, from the example of Europe, trade promotion is critical because it then builds into the common market gradually. So trade promotion. Now, if Africa, trade among ourselves is about 8%. So all our trade is going this way. It doesn't go this way. Can we trade more? Convert, buy its oil from Nigeria. Do you have cocoa here? Ghana, we have a lot of cocoa. We ship it and we have the sea. And so trade improves between Ghana and Kevet. As time goes on, you may say, okay, Ghana cocoa, we've been buying for a long time. Now, no custom on Ghana cocoa. Cocoa did not help Ghana. We don't eat chocolate. But chocolate is good for the heart. Chocolate is expensive for the Ghanaian. Because we send the cocoa beans, they do the chocolate, and then they bring it to us, and it's expensive. And so people are talking that we should begin to prepare chocolate. But Europe is now using some synthetic material to produce chocolate. Yeah. It is not from cocoa. It is not good like cocoa, but they are doing it. Now, the problem is that Europe is using the synthetic material, but Europe population is not growing. Now you look, one child, two children. So the population is not growing. So the market is stagnant, it's standing, and they are producing. And Ghana is producing cocoa, Ivory Coast is producing cocoa, and I think Argentina is also producing cocoa. So, and where? South America too, yeah. So the price of, world price of cocoa is coming down. If we can manufacture cocoa, Ghana cocoa, and supply Nigeria, 170 million people, even if 20 million people eat chocolate a day, Ghana will make it. But we've not sat down to do all these things, you see, to build the infrastructure, to build, to promote the trade. Ghana cannot simply do it, you see. The problem is that that's why I have to promote it. If Ghana goes for loan, we take a loan, we put the factory, we produce the chocolate. Because we are new, the cost of chocolate will be higher than the cost of chocolate from Europe. So for Ghana to be successful, the Cape Verde government should put tariff on chocolate from Europe to make the price higher, to help Ghana to sell. Cape Verde will not do that if it's not going to benefit from Ghana, if we don't have a trade agreement. Because trade is mutual, it's not one way. I give you, you give me, that's how it is. So it calls for proper planning. Of course, Cape Verde will lose if it raises tariff for European chocolate. European business would ask their government to punish Cape Verde for other things. Maybe they are giving you money for social welfare, they will cut it. So how would Cape Verde benefit? It's a complex thing. It's very complicated, you understand.